Good evening. When we finally leave this world, the only thing that really matters, or is going to matter, is our contribution to either science or art. And having great knowledge now in this world doesn't count that much anymore like it did in the past. You have smartphones, everything is available. It's not really about knowledge anymore. It's about discovery and creation. High quality work is also not scarce anymore. There's abundance of good quality products and services that are available all over the world. But what is really scarce is trust, connection, and surprise. And those are the three elements really in the work of a successful artist. But what really is, what is art? Art isn't pretty, it isn't just a painting or something that you hang on the wall. Art is what we create when we are truly alive. And it's not about some great talent to create something. I think it's about just being yourself and bringing out what you believe in. And what is good design? Good design is not about just making something pretty or doing something very different or about variety. I think it's really about understanding a need and creating a very special experience that addresses that need. And it must achieve functional utility and an emotional connect. And good design comes from the pursuit of a single thought, a single idea, and a singular direction. There are many examples of this. There's the Mac, or there are, for example, the Ferrari, which if you look at 60-year-old model to what it is today, or the Lamborghini, it's about one single approach to create something good, or the works of architects like Frank Lloyd Wright. And the more specific your idea, the more its appeal is likely to be. And therefore, sometimes artists spend a lot of time trying to develop their vocabulary. In architecture, there's Tadao Ando, who spent a lot of time trying to develop polished concrete, and Zaha Hadid with composite fiber, or Kengo Kuma with wood, and Frank Gehry with metal, or you could use brick. Good design is also about making a connection, and through that connection, good design is able to evoke emotion, and it takes a lot of passion and commitment to really create that. It's not just about an idea, it's not just about a thought, it's about really putting it to work. The concept of the idea is 5%, 95% is about how you execute it, and that takes a ton of work and a ton of commitment to that work. So I was very fortunate when I passed out of Kharagpur to get this opportunity to design a stud farm for a racehorse breeder in Pune. And for some reason he, Mr. Poonawala, the younger brother of the two brothers who ran that place, trusted this young kid out of college to design his farms. I think the important thing there was to put everything that you have to the maximum extent that you can, you know, get out of yourself, and that's what I tried to do. I got this opportunity to design, but also what he did was he said, don't just give me your drawings. You're going to stand here and you're going to build what you've drawn. Don't think you can just give me those drawings and get me stuck with some contractor. You're going to do all of this. And that's you know, what I was looking for. So I actually got this opportunity to build out whatever I had designed. And fortunately, he wanted something really good. So he actually pointed his finger at me and said, don't try to save my money. I want the best. You architects, you create budgets and then you try to work within budgets. Don't do that kind of thing. I want absolutely the best. But also, there was the Asian Racing Conference that was coming up in 8 months. In Bombay, and 250 delegates from that conference were expected to come down to Pune, which is where this was, and to see the farms. And so he said, all of this has to be finished. So this was an old farm with old, broken down kind of buildings. There were no roads. So all that work, putting up 7 new buildings, we had to do in 8 months. And so we literally, I made a plan for 90 days, because I knew if I made an 8-month plan, it's not going to work. Probably, there would be surprises, there would be unplanned things that would happen, and the plan would fail. So I said the only way to do it is to make sure that all 7 buildings, every single item of work that can run in parallel needs to run in parallel. So we started excavation for all 7 buildings on day 1, and poured the foundations on day 2. And my plan was really for just 90 days. Theoretically, in 90 days, it could be done. All these 7 buildings could be finished, and the roads and landscaping and a mini race course of 25 acres, all of that theoretically could be done. And I think I was stupid enough to actually believe that it can really be done. So I started out like that, and we worked till 3 in the morning every single day, including the weekends. Collapsed 3 times actually, in just out of not sleeping and eating and stuff like that. But we did, because of that crazy 90-day plan, the 90 days obviously became 100 and 110 and 130 and 140. And finally, on 27 Jan, so this we started in June of 94, and 27 Jan 95, when the delegates were coming in from Bombay, we had actually finished, in 8 months, finished all the 7 buildings. This is one of them. There were these paddocks where you have the horses, and all the landscaping. This is another building. Not very large buildings, but this is a equine gallery where the horses are paraded in the lawns, and there were people like M.A.M. Ramaswamy from here, and the Vijay Malia and Deepak Khaitan, people like that, who would come to buy 15, 20 horses every year. So they would be wine and dine inside, and the horses would be paraded here. So this building, and so all of that we did manage to finish, and that was, I think, a very fortunate break. You never know where you get a break, or maybe you just treat everything, every opportunity as a break, and put everything into it, and sometimes it really works. For me, when I went into IIT Kharagpur, I didn't know too much about architecture at all. I was quite clueless, actually. I knew it's about putting up buildings, but very little else. I was very, very inspired by the works of a few people. We have a phenomenal library in our college, and Asia's largest technical library, which had almost every book you can think of on architecture. And it was that it was these books that actually inspired me to, and I completely fell in love with architecture. So this is these are the works of people like, this is Bart Prince, there's a guy called Bruce Goff, that's Kevin Roche, Frank Lloyd Wright, and all of this work is Frank Lloyd Wright. So very inspirational. I saw stuff like this, and suddenly I just wanted to do nice buildings. So what is good design in the context of housing? For when I passed out of Kharagpur, and even till very recently, design in the housing space, housing is a very commercialized sector. It's completely real estate developers and all over the world. And so design really meant mostly gimmick or styling or decoration. It didn't really mean design. There was almost no examples. There were very, very few examples of good architecture, except from the Habitat in Montreal by Moshe Safdi, or the Kanchenjunga apartments in Bombay by Charles Correa. There was almost no other example worldwide of anybody trying to do something interesting in architecturally in the housing space, where you're really exploring space and trying to make the space much better. Typically, the word apartment brought something like this to your mind. It is something that you can adjust to, something that you can somehow manage to live in for some time. You could select all kinds of materials and finishes and expensive art, furniture, all kinds of things to make that place better, but none of that changed the inherent nature of that space. The space was still that dead space. So on the other hand, you have buildings like this. This is a building by Mies van der Rohe near Chicago. It's a 1,500 square foot glass box sitting on 80 acres of land. And so as far as you can see in all four directions, it's completely green. I'm sure everybody in Ooty can relate to something like this. Or this one, which is Frank Lloyd Wright's Falling Water House, which was built on 234 acres of a hillside on a real live waterfall. So the question really was, how do we create something like this, that kind of an experience inside a high-rise, high-density housing project inside the city? And that was really the challenge with which we set out, but very quickly realized as architects that it's not going to work because we design stuff for other people and they wouldn't, you know, it wouldn't get built that way, it would just change. And so we realized that the only way it's going to work is if we ourselves take on the responsibility of designing, constructing, building, and selling, and essentially becoming developers ourselves, and taking on that entire responsibility to deliver something. And that's how our company, Total Environment, was born. So there were seven things that we had to change completely, which don't happen in this industry worldwide for some strange reason. I think mainly because it's not commercially, doesn't make too much sense for a business. The first one, which is very integral to any home, is the idea of having a garden with the home. And the first thing we couldn't understand when we started out is, how can you build a home and not have a garden? And why is it so difficult to have a garden in an apartment on a higher floor? Even if it's the 7th floor or the 15th floor, it's no big deal. You can always cantilever a little slab, put some soil in it, put some irrigation and some plants, and you can have a garden. And so we introduced this concept with the second project that we did in 1997. And everything we do now always has a garden. This is a 6,000 square feet apartment, a 19-story apartment. Every room opens out to a garden and a deck and a water body. And that's typically how you do it in various different formats, in double height or alternate cantilevers or terrace. There are different ways you can do it. But just this whole idea that there is a patch of green that you can step out onto, that you can engage with nature even if you're on a higher floor. The second thing that we do very differently is use natural materials. Natural materials age gracefully. They blend with the surroundings. Buildings look nicer, just like your school building here. Buildings look nicer as they grow older and not worse. Natural materials just age so gracefully, and they have character. They are alive. If you see this wall, every brick has got its own character. It's not just a flat, dead surface. So not just outside, but also inside. Instead of tiles and aluminum or plastic, we use mostly wood and natural stones so that you get that warmth of a home, and the home ages beautifully. The third thing that we realized is that you cannot separate furniture from the rest of the house. Furniture is completely integral to the design of a space. If you're thinking of a bedroom, and there are windows, there's an entry door, there are lights, the furniture needs to engage with all of those things, and you can't expect a home buyer to find something outside in the market that will work. So we just believe that selling a home or making a home without furniture is pretty much like trying to sell a car without the seats and then expecting somebody to somehow make it work. So we made that a part of everything that we do, whether it's cabinetry or beds or bookshelves or study tables. Everything is thought of with the design, and the homes are built completely furnished. The fourth thing that we realize is that you cannot just expect people to move in to a home and adjust to it for, on a standard floor plan or a standard design. Everybody has very different requirements. Families are different. Some have elderly parents living with them. Some have young kids. Somebody has got three dogs. someone loves music, very different requirements. And if you've designed a building with 200 homes with 3-bedroom and 2-bedroom, and all the floor plans are the same, how can you expect all these different families to fit into the same plan? They need, the homes need to be customized. You need to understand what are the needs of each of those families and then design around them. Initially, we did this manually, and then over time, around 2008, we developed a software platform that allows the customers to do it themselves. They can actually reconfigure their floor plans, select what kind of materials and finishes they like, or select which switch needs to control which light, down to that detail. Everything is customized. The fifth difference is the approach to design itself. So design, like I mentioned earlier, is typically in the housing real estate space is all about marketing. It's about what's going on the brochure. It's about the lobbies and the the exterior of the building. About sometimes it's trying to create Venice in Bangalore or Spain in some other place. It's not really about looking at what the what the space is like and how it's going to be used. What is the family going to be doing inside the home? How are they going to use that? Our focus when we talk about design is entirely around how the space is going to be used and how is it going to work. The sixth is the approach to construction. So again, the problem in the whole housing industry is that it's completely left to real estate developers. Real estate developers typically are essentially land bankers, financiers, and sales guys. Everything else is typically outsourced. Construction is not done the way it is done in the automobile industry. It's not about thinking about every little part of the building and how it's going to be built. So our approach has been to build our own verticals for each part of the building. So there's a team that does doors and windows across projects that has expertise in just doing doors and windows for the last 20 years. And their goal in life is to make the best doors and windows in the world. Similarly, there's a team that does all the furniture. There's a team that does the landscaping and the flooring or the brickwork. So there are different teams, each one specializing in each part of the building. So everything is built in-house, and that way you have control on the final finished product. And the seventh thing is about managing the properties. Typically, at least in the past, people would finish and then run, walk away. We've always believed that you need to be around and to support the project, support the buyers, the homeowners for many years. So we typically manage our projects for life. I'll just quickly run through some of the work. These are just some of the buildings that we've done in Bangalore. And this is a concept where the garden is inside the house and the windows are outside. Just to show you the materials. This is a project called Windmills of Your Mind. What you see down there are earth-covered homes. So those green roofs. This is the project. All those gardens, those are actual banana trees growing up there in somebody's house. So people have done all kinds of things in their gardens. Those are the green roofs. The other thing is also about, the point I really want to talk about is the fact that when you are designing something, the best design is about solving the problem. And I think understanding the problem is 95% of the work. So solutions come very easily when you've understood what the problem is. And so one of the things, for example, all over the world, when people build individual homes on plots of land, on anything less than 20,000 square feet lots, typically it's 5,000 square feet or 8,000 square feet, you would find that there are these lots and then there are blocks plonked right in the middle of them. And then between two homes, you have a narrow passage. You can almost hear what's being, the TV in the next home, or you can smell the food that's being cooked. You have little passages all around, you hardly have a garden. It just made common sense when you look at that if you want to, I think I've not put in the plans here, but to move the house to one side and not to put a block in the middle. Instead of a rectangular block, convert it into an L, and then just place it along one side, put the other house with a common back to this, and suddenly what you get is an L shape with all the garden being brought inside the L instead of it being passages around. And now every single space in the home in that L opens out to the garden. The distance between one face of the L and the other one on the opposite side is about 48 feet if it's a 50-foot lot, each of the lots. And so it just works much better. And so solutions just come from understanding what the problem is. So these are the homes. So this is one of those typical homes, which is about 4,800 square feet lot. But like I said, you can create that open space with every room opening out to the garden. And the distance between this and the next house is about 48 feet. And the other thing that we love to do is to green everything that we can green. So we plant stuff all over the place, or on the roofs of the buildings. This is a clubhouse and the pool for one of the projects, and the roof is green, overhanging with plants so that they act like a curtain, keep out the sun, and just feel nice. This is another project of ours in Pune. This is in Hyderabad with earth-covered homes where the roof comes down all the way to the ground. This is a project that we are really looking forward to building right here in Ooty, not too far from here. In the hills, it's a resort. It's going to be called the Saucer Full of Secrets. It's a beautiful saucer-shaped building which has the restaurants and stuff like that. And then part of it is a pet resort, so there would be kennels for about 60 kennels for dogs. And then cottages like this coming out of the hillside so that you don't, it's so disastrous to see so many of these pink and blue and white buildings sticking out in Ooty. Instead of that, if you just did something like this where it's, you hardly see anything. So this is what we are proposing to build. We are at the last leg of getting the approvals to get started. And you don't have to limit yourself to just one thing. If you really enjoy, if you have a passion, we decided some time back to set up a brewery. I love music, so this is a live music venue where we have really good food, beer, and good music. So that's the stage where performances are held. And this is another restaurant that we set up that with a lot of research that serves authentic Karnataka food from every corner of the state. It's called Uta Bangalore. And I'll just run through. This is something we are doing in the US. So it's just similar earth-covered homes. And this is a brewery there. And that's some of the music that we've brought down from different parts of the world. So end of the day, it's also about enjoying everything that you do. Thank you.